Belinda and Harper Audio Australia present this unabridged recording of Gus and the Starlight, written by Victoria Carless and read by Edwina Wren. For Minnie. Chapter 1. The screen door burst open, slapping against the faded weatherboards. Gus jumped in the middle seat, where she waited with her brother and sister in the sky-blue sedan. Through the grimy windscreen, she saw her mother wrestling their beat-up suitcase down the front path, the hem of her cheesecloth dress snagging on dandelions. The flowers looked nice, but they were a weed, Gus knew, and nobody cared for them. Mrs. Abel wore jeans and sneakers under her dress and a brown cardigan over it, as well as the tartan coat that had once been Gran's. Gus and her siblings wore most of their clothes too, including pyjamas under their school uniforms and their shabby winter coats, all bought from Salvo's. The Camry was whining, the engine nagging at their mother to hurry up. Beside her, Alice, Gus's big sister by 1 year, leaned her head against the window, her breath fogging up the glass. Her posture was resigned. Her whole body said, "Here we go again." Their little brother, Artie, was kicking the driver's seat and wailing he'd left his Transformers inside. Gus knew she should go get them, but her stomach hurt and her feet were tingly and she was having trouble breathing. She worried if she moved, she would shatter into tiny pieces. So she stayed put, immobile in the middle seat, hoping she wouldn't spontaneously combust. She felt the boot fling open and heard her mother toss the heavy suitcase in. Inside the case, everything would be jumbled, all the possessions they owned, which had followed them from house to house, cracked and nearly broken things, worn down and out by wear. Then Mrs. Abel was in the driver's seat, throwing her handbag beside her. She said something low and sweary as she flung the gear stick into reverse. The children in the back seat collectively released the breath they'd been holding, and the family slid backwards down the driveway. Putting the car into gear, their mother angled the Camry down the street and, just like that, they were gone. Gus watched their suburb, home for the last few months, flash by. Here, the houses all looked the same. Gappy timber workers' cottages that hunkered against the southerlies, their paint tired and their furniture mismatched. They were places full of things the owners hadn't chosen for themselves. They were houses where no one stayed long enough to give them any love. As her mother drove Troy's car away from the place that had Troy's name on the lease, Gus looked out the window and saw they had reached the high street with its graffitied tram stops, the stores that sold fake flowers and the chicken takeaway shops and their smell of hot chips and grease. Gus felt lightheaded and didn't know if it was because she was hungry or because of what had happened earlier that evening. She saw their dinner, frozen meals from a box, mushy and steaming from the microwave, going soggy at the table. She concentrated on making a list, the way Gran had shown her. Gus began to list books she had read. It didn't matter what she listed, Gran had told her. It could be books or the periodic table of elements, the names of the pet fish who had swum briefly in and out of their lives, or the list of streets on which they had lived. The important thing was making an inventory in her head to distract herself. Gus got to Little Women before she became aware of the car again and the warmth generated by the crush of the three siblings in the back seat. Their mother nudged the accelerator further to the floor and they sped towards the highway exit. At Gus's feet was the library book she had borrowed the week before, Matilda, a story she had read so many times it felt like they were old friends. Also at her feet were the sandwiches in a paper bag that Alice had smashed together on their way out the door, an unappetizing mix of stale bread and jam for their dinner. It was going to be a Meals on Wheels night, with a difference, again. In fact, by the look of their mother's determined driving, they might be on the road for some time. As they approached the library, which was on the last turnoff before the highway, Gus retrieved the book at her feet and held it aloft. "Mum," she said, "can I just..." Their mother glanced back at her sharply. The look on her face made Gus halt. "We're not stopping tonight," her mother said. Gus opened her mouth to protest. Not returning the book was like stealing. She would get a fine. The late fees, a blemish on her otherwise perfect library record. She'd been hoping to get a library card of her own soon. She'd only ever had temporary ones on account of them not having a permanent address. Alice gave Gus a look, one that said, "Don't even start." They definitely weren't stopping tonight. It was lucky she hadn't made any friends here, Gus thought, as she wouldn't have been able to say goodbye. Their mother's phone lit up on the front passenger seat, and the jangly ringtone cut through the silence in the car. They ignored it, but Gus saw Mrs. Abel tighten her grip on the steering wheel. "It is so lucky," she repeated to herself, "that I don't have anyone to miss." That had been something she'd learned, a special trick cultivated along the way. Gus was really good now at not making any friends at all. The mobile screeched again, and Gus's stomach contracted. This time Mrs. Abel glanced over at it. Her face told them who the caller was. Troy would be wondering where they were. He would be wondering about the payment he'd decided he was due. The deal had been that they could only stay in his house if their mother did psychic readings for cash. "Can't we say goodbye to Troy?" Artie whined. He was the youngest, so he was still learning about their mother's looks, the secret code Alice and Gus had begun to understand as they grew, the looks that said, "Don't ask, girls," or the one that said, "I'm okay, kids," when she clearly wasn't. Artie was still learning about what their mother did for a living, why she was visited at odd hours by strangers asking questions about their dead relatives, why she sat at a folding table in a corner of the lounge room with these strangers, lighting candles and speaking in hushed tones, and why sometimes she or they cried. Artie was especially still learning how people like Troy, who managed their mother's affairs and were their sometimes fathers, often took the bigger cut. Troy would probably be at the pub now, Gus knew. He'd be trying to make some money on the dogs with his tracksuit-wearing associates. Or worse, he'd be trying to rustle up more business. Troy had been short of money lately, some deal gone bad, and had got angry when the couple who had sat at the card table in their house that evening had refused to pay. Their mother hadn't been able to reach their son's spirit. In Troy's view, this was entirely her fault, both that she'd failed to contact the dead man and because she didn't get the money up front. But Gus knew that sometimes this happened, and her mother wasn't actually to blame. She had noticed that sometimes ghosts just didn't want to be found by the living. Being at the table with dark-clothed strangers trying to call up their lost loved ones was her mother's job, but it didn't seem to be her choice. And it wasn't a job she could forget about out of work hours either. Gus recalled how after most readings lately their mother disappeared to her bedroom, pale and drained. She would emerge the next morning, her forehead ridged with worries and her blue-grey eyes flicking around the room chasing spectres. Gus knew her mother wanted to help the people who came to their door, desperate for contact with their dead, but her so-called gift was taking its toll. Tonight, after the black-clad woman and man had left and before he had gone to the pub, Troy had ranted and thrown their mother's belongings around the room. Their mother had taken this latest frenzy, the worst one yet, as their cue to leave, bundling the children up like charity shop wares as soon as Troy left the house. Gus wondered what Troy would do when he found out they'd taken his car. Their mother's mobile screeched again. It was Troy's name flashing on the screen. "Block him, would you please?" their mother asked Alice via the rearview mirror. Alice nodded and reached around Gus to take the phone from the front seat. She did as their mother asked and then tossed the mobile on the floor, shoving it out of sight with her foot.
"Mom," Artie whined.
"We're not stopping," their mother said again. It was almost like she was telling herself as much as them.
Oh, Artie said. Now Alice shot their brother her don't look. Gus, on a reflex, tickled Artie, who couldn't help but laugh and squirm away from her. He quietened down after that, and the three of them sat still as stones in the back seat. As Mrs. Abel looked at the children in the rearview mirror, Gus saw her mother's mouth was pressed into a line. Gus gazed out the window at the city rushing by. Goodbye, house. Goodbye, street. Goodbye, school. Goodbye, library. Goodbye, trams. Goodbye, chicken shops, she said under her breath. Gus said goodbye the way she had to plenty of other places, plenty of times before. She looked up at the night sky, which was an inky velvet now, with the first star of evening peeping through. Goodbye, Troy, she added. This one, she said out loud, willing it to be final. Chapter 2. They slept, draped over each other in the back seat, like a pile of puppies, while their mother drove through the night. Gus half woke a few times, such as when they passed through a cluster of streetlights watching over a sleeping town. Other times it was when a semi-trailer overtook them, the rumble of the truck's tyres and the throaty roar of the engine a kind of late-night lullaby. One time when Gus woke, Mrs. Abel had the demister and the wipers on, accompaniments to the hum of midnight wind, and always the headlights, casting a low-down moonlight over the slate road with its mesmerising dotted line. Driving in the dark on the empty highway was like being in space, Gus thought. She felt weightless, their tinny car bobbing in the universe like a strange astronomical body, a lost star maybe. Another time when she opened her eyes, Gus thought for a moment she was under the sea, the deepest, darkest part where the strange fish dwelled, those glimpsed in the furthest underwater room in the aquarium, the one hardly anyone visited. Only once during the night did Gus wake properly. Her mother stopped for petrol, and the lights of the service station glimmered through the windscreen like those of an alien ship. She blinked and rubbed her eyes, momentarily afraid her family would be beamed up. She was relieved when she saw her mother through the servo window, the glass thick with condensation, buying supplies. Gus's belly gnawed at her. The jam sandwiches were long gone, and so when her mother handed her a bottle of strawberry milk as she slipped back into the driver's seat, Gus was grateful. Share it with the others, her mother said. But she smiled as she said it, and Gus knew it was their little secret. Sometimes she pretended she was her mother's favourite. She had to be someone's favourite, didn't she? It was a law of the universe, she felt sure. She just hadn't figured out whose yet. There was still time, however. She was only nearly 12, after all. It was going to be her birthday in a month. Perhaps she would know more then, about how not to make friends or avoid imploding from worry, about how not to become like her mother. Gus regarded her siblings from the middle seat. Artie, now dressed in his dinosaur pajamas, was snoring lightly, his sandy hair all mussed. His mouth was open, revealing his 5 missing teeth. He was like that, Artie, a kid who did everything at once, including losing all his front teeth. He would miss his mates in year one. He had fared the best of them with the spin cycle of house moves they had been through. Alice still looked pretty, even as she slept upright in the car. Her honey-coloured hair shimmered around her pale face, and her mouth rested in a perfect bow. She even sleeps neatly, Gus thought. In contrast, Gus's mousy brown hair, usually cut in a bob, stuck up all over. She could feel a crust of drool that had formed by her lip. People often couldn't believe she and Alice were sisters. It was true the children had different fathers. Even so, they shared a firecracker of a mother, and that was surely the bigger portion of their makeup and the thing that bound them. Still, the sisters were like chalk and cheese, their mother always said. Gus wondered which one she was supposed to be. Gus was surprised that Alice and Artie had been able to sleep at all. They had been on the road together before, but not like this. They hadn't ever driven through the night. Instead, they had shuffled through the suburbs of the city, in and out of borrowed houses, borrowed cars, borrowed lives. Troy's was the 10th.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.